All right, so for lecture 17A today, we're going to look at applications of the Orbis stabilizer theorem. One application. I introduced the idea of an external direct product last time, but there's also the idea of what you might call product in quotes of subgroups, which is kind of related but kind of different. We'll see what I mean when I get to that. Do some calculations with external direct products. 17B will probably be more calculations, some theorems related to isomorphism facts for external direct products, and hopefully if we have time we will introduce the first idea in chapter 9, the idea of a normal subgroup. Here's something a little mildly humorous. You remember last time how I was doing the proof of the fact that odd and end were mathematical group invariants? And I said, you know, this is a real abstract thing. I was drawing the picture on the board. And I said, this is called abstract nonsense. Well, abstract nonsense is a real thing. It even has its own Wikipedia page. You know it must be real if that's the case. Look at that, abstract nonsense. In mathematics, abstract nonsense, or general abstract nonsense, or general nonsense, are terms used by mathematicians to describe abstract methods related to something called category theory and homological algebra. More generally, abstract nonsense may refer to a proof that relies on category theoretical methods or even the study of category theory itself. What does that mean? Well, basically category theory is where you're drawing a bunch of objects, they could be groups, and a bunch of arrows, could be isomorphisms, and you got all these relationships. Now, I had a pretty small diagram on the board last time. Remember that one that I had over here? I have this one. I had something over there as well. And I was giving you this abstract argument for why ought was an invariant of groups, meaning if you got two isomorphic groups, then the corresponding automorphism groups are also isomorphic. It was a very abstract argument, okay? Mathematicians might call that abstract nonsense. It's somewhat similar to what you can find in this thing called category theory. However, I should emphasize that just because something like this is called abstract nonsense does not mean it is unimportant, okay? That fact that I emphasized that ought is invariant is actually a pretty important thing for our classification scheme. It would mean, for example, if two groups have non-isomorphic automorphism groups, then those original groups must be non-isomorphic as well, not isomorphic. Okay? So it gives you tools for classification. But I hope you appreciate our textbook. You know, I haven't really talked about real-life applications, but there's plenty of real-life applications in our textbook. Right? Have you noticed all of them? To what? Things like, well, ISBN codes, which seems like kind of maybe a boring application. Your ISBN code on your books. Check digits in general, which was more important when they first came out. We didn't have laser scanners back 30 years ago. And so the cashier actually had to type in your ISBN, okay? And the cashier could make a mistake, and so the check digit could catch the mistakes. So it was more important back then, perhaps. But still important, maybe, today. Maybe more important, I guess I would claim certainly more important, is cryptography, secret codes and computer security, number theory, and especially Fermat's little theorem, which is in the section about Lagrange's theorem as a corollary of Lagrange's theorem, is very important for cryptography. Okay, secret codes. Super important for us, right? Because internet security is all based on it. Maybe you've read things about how with quantum computers, which they're trying to make these days, it will like break all the internet security out there and so nothing will be secure anymore. So why are they trying to do it? Well, the government figures somebody's out there trying to do it, so they better try to do it too to like figure out how to stop them perhaps or something. I don't know. I always claim as a funny story, if you ever come up with some sort of unbreakable code, or maybe a way to break seemingly unbreakable codes, probably you'll get kidnapped. either by the U.S. government or maybe the Chinese government or something, right? They don't want you getting that secret out there. They'll probably kidnap you and you'll never be seen again. So I don't. That's probably not such a good thing to work on, perhaps. Or you'd end up working for the NSA or something, right? Okay. So anyway, it is important, but it is sometimes the subject of spy movies. It was mentioned in chapter 8 that there are applications to genetics, electric circuits, and Rubik's Cube, which was mentioned earlier. And I always found interesting looking back on page 108, if you want to look there. The author talks about the Rubik's Cube and how you can use group theory to prove various things. And it says in 1995, it was proved that there was a starting configuration of the Rubik's Cube that requires at least 20 moves to solve. And only in 2010, 8 years ago, it was determined that every cube configuration, no matter what you start with, can be solved in at most 20 moves. So 20 is the best you can do in general. Okay, but you can also solve anything in that many moves. So that's a pretty amazing thing. Evidently it takes group theory and evidently a lot of computation time on computers to confirm this. Okay? About 35 CPU years donated by Google to complete this calculation. Wow. Pretty cool. It involves group theory. We've also been reading about symmetries of objects. Like a soccer ball or a football to our international audience. Not a very good soccer ball. Not a standard soccer ball. We lost our standard soccer ball. So this one's a little harder to tell. In looking at the symmetries of a soccer ball, it's harder to see the pentagons and hexagons here. Maybe you want to zoom in on this. Of course, this picture is better. What's the group, not of reflectional symmetries, but rotational symmetries of a soccer ball? The orbit stabilizer theorem can be used to figure it out. And that is important, I forgot to mention, also, for crystallography, not cryptography, crystallography, buckyballs. Have you heard of a buckyball? Anybody heard of a buckyball before? Its more official name is Buckminster fullerene. Buckminster fullerene. It's a molecule that looks like a soccer ball. actually, I think I didn't look into this before class, but I think they actually have to do some sort of industrial process to make this thing. It doesn't occur naturally. But it's sort of the most symmetric molecule out there, and you can use it to make very tough carbon fibers or something that are like unbreakable if they're of a certain thickness or something. Buckminster fullerene, or buckyballs, it looks like a soccer ball. It's got the rotation group of a soccer ball. And when you do crystallography, group theory is useful. Understanding symmetries of objects is a useful thing in understanding the structure of crystals, crystallography. Okay, now what about the rotation group of a soccer ball? One way to figure it out is to use the orbit stabilizer theorem. Let G be a finite group of permutations. Hey, what about the group of permutations induced by rotations of a soccer ball? Permutations of, say, the pentagons. Okay, how many pentagons are there on a soccer ball? There are 12 of them. You can zoom in if you want here. This is one. Okay, again, this is not a standard soccer ball, not a standard football. So it's a bit hard to see there, but that's a pentagon. Anytime you see these stars there, that's a pentagon. And let G be the group of rotational symmetries, which would also be a group of permutations on those pentagons. S would be the set of pentagons, of which there are 12 of them. You could label them 1 through 12. The order of G would be the product of these two things. What's the order of the stabilizer of any pentagon? Well, the only rotations that are going to fix a given pentagon like this are going to be 5 of them, one of which is just the identity rotation, don't rotate it at all. Another of which would be a rotation through the axis that goes to the center of this pentagon through the other one on the back here. By what? 360 divided by 5 would be what? 72 degrees? 144 degrees? 216 degrees? 288 degrees and 360 degrees is really the same as not rotating at all. You've got five rotational symmetries that fix any given pentagon. The order of the stabilizer is five for any I. I represents one of these pentagons. What about the orbit of the pentagon? Well, if you think about it carefully, it's pretty easy to see that given one pentagon and some other pentagon that's not the opposite one, say, that there's some rotational symmetry, there's some permutation of the pentagons, that some rotation that will take that pentagon to any other one. It's a little hard to see for the one that's exactly opposite from it, even though you might think that would be easy. But, for example, if I want to rotate this one to this one, I need to rotate about this pentagon 144 degrees. If I want to rotate this one to, say, this one, I can rotate around an axis through this one, 144 degrees. What about the one opposite from it? It's a little hard to tell because they're not quite oriented correctly, it seems, when you look at them. You probably can't tell real easily. But I'm looking at this pentagon and this one, and they're not 180 degree rotation about. It's not clear that they're going to match up, actually. It doesn't seem like they're oriented right. But I think I convinced myself that if you rotate it around an axis, I think it's through the middle of this line segment right there. Take that line segment on that hexagon, take its midpoint, take an axis through there. I think I convinced myself that that's a rotational symmetry that will take one pentagon to the one on the other side. I'm not positive, okay? It's not a proof. But the book did claim that any pentagon can be rotated to any other pentagon. And so therefore you've got 12 things in the orbit, because there's 12 pentagons. 12 times 5 is 60. The order of the group of rotational symmetries is 60. That doesn't tell you it's isomorphic to, it just tells you there's 60 elements, but that will reduce the possibilities. Turns out to be isomorphic to A5. Though that's not obvious, okay? Okay, I want to tell you some funny stories here too. When I was a kid, okay, well, I didn't grow up learning soccer. In fact, my parents never even told me about soccer. I'm sorry, international audience people, I know it's the most popular sport in the world, football. But I didn't know anything about soccer. I was in third grade, and our Phi Ed teacher says, hey, we're going to play soccer today. I'm like, soccer? What soccer? I had no idea how to play it. I had no idea the rules. So I'm kind of wandering around as all the other kids are kicking the ball around. All of a sudden, they kick the ball to me. It's coming to me. I don't know what to do. I catch it. Bad, bad, bad. But my first terrible experience in sports. Everybody's like, why, you stupid? You're not supposed to catch the ball. I'll tell you other funny stories about sports and growing up for me late in other classes. That's my story for the day today. So that was my introduction to soccer. So, yeah, there are lots of bad sports stories in my life. But anyway, it's kind of fun to bring up now. And it is an application of group theory. Here's another useful fact. Okay, this was in the reading. I haven't talked about it yet. Sizes of products, quote-unquote, of subgroups. This is not the same as external direct product, though it is going to be related in certain situations. Let H and K be two finite subgroups of a group G. Define a new set HK by what you would think by now, I hope. You know, we've used this kind of notation a number of times. This should represent the set of all products of things in H with things in K, with the things in H on the left and the things in K on the right. And yeah, that's how we define it. Set of all products, little h times little k, as little h varies over capital H and little k varies over capital K. Turns out then that you can say this is true. Now I'm not going to prove it. You can study the book's proof, and it doesn't involve Lagrange's theorem actually, but it is a counting theorem, so it fits in this section. It's got some pretty cool applications. In fact, maybe the second most interesting proof we've done so far, the first most was the one we talked about last time, is in this section, is an application of this fact here, and it's example 6 on page 144. Let me do an example similar to that. This application, I'll come back to this note here in a few minutes. Look at this application. I claim a group of order 18 can have at most one subgroup of order 9. Now, if the group were cyclic, we know there would be exactly one subgroup of order 9. But what if it's not cyclic? I claim it can have at most one subgroup of order 9. You could argue by contradiction. A G of order 18, which, by the way, is 2 times 3 squared, 2 times 9. And suppose, to the contrary, that G has more than one subgroup of order 9. Okay? Take two of them. There could be more than two. Let H and K be two such distinct subgroups of order 9. What can you say? Can you get a contradiction? I claim this equation can give you a contradiction. We know that the intersection of subgroups of any group is a subgroup, right? We proved that one day. The one or two subgroup test. It was actually a pretty easy proof in the big scheme of things. You can say that the intersection of H and K is a subgroup of H, and it's also a subgroup of K. I'm going to use a colon there to just emphasize it's a subgroup of both of them. And these have order 9. And in fact, let me erase something here. Let me make this a strict subgroup symbol. Since I'm assuming H and K are distinct, not the same, the intersection must be small, right? H is here and K is there, their intersection is here. Now, if we were talking infinite groups, H intersect K could still be infinite in size and order, but we're talking finite groups here. H intersect K does have to be strictly small. Lagrange, we can apply Lagrange's theorem here as well. And the fact that these things have order 9, to say that then that the intersection of H and K has order 1 or 3, right? Divisors of 9 that do not equal 9. What would that imply about this set HK then, based on this equation? Based on that equation, that would imply the set HK equals the order of H times the order of K, 9 times 9 over 1, or 9 times 9 over 3, 81 or 27. But wait a minute, that's not possible. G has order 18. HK is certainly a subset of G. Subset, not necessarily a subgroup. It can't have more elements than G does. There's your contradiction. So the original assumption that G had more than one subgroup of order 9 must be false, therefore it has at most one subgroup of order 9. It might not have any subgroup of order 9. We saw last time that A4, which has order 12, has no subgroup of order 6. So a group of order 18 might not have any subgroup of order 9, but if it has one, it won't have any more. It has at most one subgroup of order 9. Okay. These are pretty significant things as far as trying to classify groups. Pretty interesting, I think, too. Note, HK is not necessarily a subgroup of G, though sometimes it is, as we will see in chapter 9. As an example, where it's not a subgroup, you could let GBS3H be the cyclic subgroup generated by 1-2, meaning, in other words, H consists of those two permutations, and K be the cyclic subgroup generated by 2-3, so it consists of these two permutations. What would the set HK be? Take all products of things in H with things in K, where the thing in the H is on the left and the thing in K is on the right. Certainly, you could use the identity elements, so you would have the identity element in there, you'd have each of these individual elements in here. When you compose on the left by the identity there, with that, you get this one. When you use this one and compose with the identity on the right, you get this one. And we would also have 1-2 composed with 2-3 in that order. And nothing else. Already this can't be a subgroup of S3 because S3 has 6 elements and this has 4. But if you want extra confirmation, you can also calculate what this is. This would be 1-2-3, that 3 cycle there is what that would equal. And you can check closure doesn't work here. Not a subgroup. But you could also use the run register. Okay, so in general, HK is not a subgroup of G. It's a subset. But sometimes it will be a subgroup. In chapter 9, we'll see situations where it is. And those are important situations. All right, back to external direct products now. So again, here's the definition. Hopefully you wrote this down, so you don't need to write it down again. I'm going to go through it quick here. You got a finite number of sets. Actually, the requirement that you have a finite number of sets is not necessary. You can actually have an infinite number of groups. Finite number of groups, I should say. You could have an infinite number, but we're restricting ourselves to the case of a finite number. The external direct product of these groups is this, as a set, the set of all n-tuples, where the ith component of the n-tuple is an element of Gi. Symbolically, you could write it like this, and the notation for it is what you see there. Again, don't be thrown off by the fact that we're using plus signs in here with circles around them. Again, when I first learned the subject, I used a different notation. This is more consistent with the idea of what I call the Cartesian product of sets. This is the notation used by our author and many other authors. The other mathematicians. Set of all ordered n-tuples. I didn't put the word ordered in there, but the order does matter, the order you put things in. Set of all symbols like this, where for each I between 1 and n, you can say that. So that's what it is as a set. The operation is done component-wise. So if you've got two such n-tuples, and you should put commas between the elements here, as I'm almost sometimes forgetting to do initially. So these are two arbitrary elements of this external direct product. When you multiply them, you multiply component-wise. So the new n-tuple that you get out has a first component, g1 times g1 bar, second component, g2 times g2 bar, third component, g3 times g3 bar, etc. The last component will be gn times gn bar. That's how you do the product. When you use n-tuple notation with vector spaces in linear algebra, you never did this kind of thing. Unless the operation was addition, then it was vector addition. So I said last time, I'll say it again, even though that's kind of in the back of your mind, you want to sort of ignore that for the moment, for the most part at least, when you're thinking about this stuff. We looked at examples. We'll continue to look at examples here in a minute, but let's look at these facts. First of all, there's a fact about the order of the group itself when you've got finitely many finite groups. In general, the groups themselves don't have to be finite when we're talking in general about
external direct products, but for this fact here, we are saying let these groups be finite groups. Then the order of the external direct product is the product of the orders of the factors, you might say, call these factors. And the thing you're going to use the most in Chapter 8 is going to be this fact. You're going to use this over and over again. The order of an element in an external direct product of a finite number of finite groups is the least common multiple of the orders of the components. In symbols, you've got this equation. Okay? It's going to be very useful for us. We can use it to do lots of calculations
with groups that are external direct products.
Oh, that was a good one. Here's another sports story. I'm really bad at basketball. Oh, I guess it's lost. There's some pop in there. Okay, it's lost. I'm really bad at basketball. Well, actually, more precisely, I'm bad at shooting. I'm okay at dribbling. I'm okay at passing. Okay at rebounding for my height. Not so good at shooting. I am amazed by people who are really good shooters. It's like, how do you do it? Especially jump shots. I just cannot do a jump shot. Anyway, and I'm bad at basketball in my office too, because every time I try to throw something away, I miss. That's of course an exaggeration, but it's like 90% of the time that I try to throw something away, I miss. Even when I'm relatively close, but there I made it by accident. We could consider examples like, how about Z4 external direct product with itself? That's a group of order 16. You might wonder, is it cyclic? Is it isomorphic to Z16? Does anybody want to say they know the answer based on reading? Is that isomorphic to Z16? If you've done the reading, you should know. If you've done the reading carefully and you understood it. Anybody? Nobody? It's not, okay? Because 4 is not relatively prime to itself. We saw last time that Z2 external direct product with Z3 was cyclic, was isomorphic to Z6. 2 and 3 are relatively prime. So I'm hinting at a general fact here. So this is not cyclic, but it does have order 16, 4 times 4. What are the orders of the elements? I don't want to list out the elements, but let's figure out how many there are of each order. Well, of course, you've got your one element of order 1, the identity 0, 0, just 1. How many elements of orders, well, the other dividers of 16, not 16 itself though, because otherwise it would be cyclic. I know there are 0 elements of order 16. Of orders 2, 4, and 8. Order 2. What can we do here? We can maybe make a little table. Think about your general element in Z4, external direct product with itself. The A's and the B's here could have orders 1, 2, or 4, right? They are both in Z4. So what are the possibilities then for the least common multiples? Maybe I'm going to think about orders 2, 4, and 8 altogether here. What are the possibilities for the least common multiples of these orders? You can maybe make a little table like this. In my key, for the completion problems, I don't make a table because it's not so easy to make a table without a lot of pain. In Mathematica, maybe I could make a little program that does it, but I haven't taken the time to do that. For orders 2, 4, and 8. So if I'm going to think about orders 2, 4, and 8, I'm going to think about it with these LCMs.
I better not pick one and one here. At least one of these numbers must be bigger than one when I'm thinking about this. So, for example, I could consider A has order 2, B has order 1, A has order 1, B has order 2, A has order 4, B has order 1, A has order 1, B has order 4. Running out of room on the board here. I could consider if they both have order 2. Okay, I'm continuing my table over here. You don't have to make a table, but if you find it to be helpful, you can. There'd be 2 and 4, 4 and 2, and 4 and 4 as well. The LCM in each case is going to be 2, 2, 4, 4, 2, 4, 4, 4. In each case, how many elements fit this? In each of the, for each of these different cases, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 cases, right? I haven't missed any, have I? Guess I could add another column here, number of elements. How about this case? There's only one such element. A is order 2, it's got to be 2. B has order 1, it's got to be 0. There's only one such element. There's only one such element for this one. A would be 0, B would be 2. These are the orders of A and B. But in these groups, A would have to be 0, B would have to be 2. For this one, there's more than one possibility, right? If A has order 4, it's a generator of Z4. It could be 1 or 3. 1 and 3 are the generators of Z4. B is still has order 1, it's still 0. So there's 2 times 1, or 2 possibilities for that. Same kind of thing with this one. I'll write it as 1 times 2 is 2. This one, it's 1 times 1. If both A and B have order 2, they must be 2. Come over here, 2 and 4. A must has order 2, so it must be 2. There's only one possibility there. B has order 4. It could be 1 or 3. It's a generator of Z4. Likewise, we get 2 times 1 is 2 here, but here we get 2 times 2. 4 possibilities there because A and B both have order 4. A could be the number 1 or the number 3, and B could be the number 1 or the number 3. I'm talking about possibilities there. In thinking about generators in that case, there are 2 generators, 1 and 3, for Z4. So, okay, collating this information, how many elements of order 2? Circle the ones where the LCM is 2, and then count the number of corresponding elements. There's going to be 3 elements of order 2, and the rest have order 4, it looks like, right? Yeah. Look at these LCMs, they're all 4 now. There should be 12 elements of order 4. Double check, 2 plus 4 is, 2 plus 2 is 4, 6, 8, 12. I'm adding up those numbers of elements. So in summary, there's one element of order 1. Sorry, this is so disorganized. 3 elements of order 2. And then 8 elements of order 4. What are the elements, for example, of order 2? They fit the circled cases there in green. They would be 2, 0, 0, 2, and in this case, 2, 2. Wait a minute, is that right? Yeah, these are the elements of order 2. Okay. Those are the 3 elements of order 2. All right, let's modify this. Or is it quiz time here? It is quiz time. Let's take the quiz.